So we recently bought a sand flag, a requirement in some areas for off-road travel, a good idea in many more. Now, it's a big sticky-up thing mounted on the car, but unlike all of the others, it's not an antenna. But perhaps it could be. If it could be both, it wouldn't collide with the 30-meter antenna when it's also mounted on the front right of the bull bar. I mean, how hard can it be? We run a wire up it, we add a coil, and we adjust, looking at the NanoVNA, until it's got an acceptable V-swer.
This is a pretty similar diameter to the sand flag, and the sand flag's a pretty similar length. So what we were thinking of doing was replicating this coil on the sand flag with this wire. I think we're just going to deliberately wind too many on, then check with the NanoVNA as we take some off and see where we get. What if we just crimp the wire down into that and just stick it in here and just use this antenna base? We'll always have this in the car, right?
Initially, we were going to have the sections linked by power pole connectors, but then we thought of doing it properly. We drilled and tapped a hole in the top and bottom of each section so the electrical contact can be through the threads. At this point, it was time to attach the other end to the vehicle.
So, good that doesn't cast a shadow. Down to that. It does a little bit, but if you're driving in the kind of spot you'd need a sand flag, you probably wouldn't be driving much at night.
Then, time to take it out to the park and see what frequency this even resonates at.
7.537.
Okay, that's higher than I thought it would be.
So let's remove some coils.
9? 10? Okay, so it's 7.8 megahertz and 3.3 to 1.
11, 12,
3.40 at 8.30.
19. I'm gonna do 30.
8.4 megahertz, 2.6 swer.
So coils come down a bit. The amount of base capacitance you have determines basically where you need to place the coil. And since we can't adjust the base capacitance as we're using the same base, the coil has to be similarly far down.
9.72,
yep.
And 2.31 to 1.
You get 10.140 at 2.2, so...
CQ, this is Victor Kilo 3, Foxtrot Uniform Romeo calling CQ, this is Victor Kilo 3, Foxtrot Uniform Romeo. Alright, so I have an idea. Because no one's calling me. I'm just going to dump 100 watts of ready into this for like an amount of time, I don't know.
Alright. That was after 30 seconds of 100 watts.
Yeah.
At this point, the V-swer is okay. It didn't emit smoke at 100 watts, but I think it'll be more efficient if we can get the coil higher up, as more of the higher current bottom part of the antenna will be made of the thicker wire we used before the coil.
So clearly just using the other base with 400 picofarads of capacitance and hoping for the best wasn't going particularly well. We'd have to put the coil very low down the antenna. So instead we're trying for a design that's a little more top-loaded, and we'll figure out our own capacitance at the bottom. Alright, so 1.96 were at 8.92. Much closer on first attempt with this design. So it seems every value of capacitor we add pulls it further out. 1.8 at 9.04. Got to dip it about the right spot. We're still 1.75. Most of the way up.
Yeah. Duplicate position packet.
Did that get the other email?
Yep.
But if we want to measure this properly, we're measuring it at this end. If we want to actually use the measurements to correct the antenna, we need to measure it at that end. And what that means is we need to calibrate it. Included with the NanoVNA are these three little calibration devices. One of them is an open circuit. The short circuit one is equally obvious. And then by process of elimination, or also careful inspection, the load one, which represents a 50 ohm load, you can see has a dielectric around the center pin and is also silver, unlike the other two. Although this does shift the calibration, that was the one thing I was meant to not do. Although we'll move the calibration plane above the socket, it's HF and the extra centimeter doesn't matter. And we'll start with the open. So now we calibrate open, short. So now that's reporting that is at 50 ohms. The real goal of this is we've got this one, but there's a rather dodgy connection between coax and the flying lead here. And we want to determine if it's RF equivalent to this one, which has the single core connected directly into a PL259. All right, whatever. So we'll start with the previous one, which we know is okay. 86.1 ohms and 109 nanohenries. Yeah, 1.7 to 1-ish. .8 ohms and 13 nanohenries. So a little more inductance because there's a little less capacitance from that section missing. About 1.68. Cool. So it's under 2 to 1. So after coax losses, this end, it's only a square of 1.4 because we've lost a bit of the return power. And there it is, the Sandflagtenna.
So now we know that both of these leads are pretty close, and it doesn't actually matter which one we use. The V-square, although not perfect, is below 2 to 1.
So the final step of the process here is that we want to cover up all of this exposed wiring so it doesn't get damaged in case of impact with trees or just generally caught in things or messing about with it. So what we're going to do here is cover it in some heat shrink. White, of course, to match how the sand flag was. Now, of course, the question you may ask is, how are we going to shrink this thing? And typically, while a lot of the time people use a cigarette lighter or a match, firstly with white heat shrink, I wouldn't recommend doing that because you'll get black burn marks all over it. And secondly, if you use a cigarette lighter, you'll probably burn your fingers and be here all week. And if you use a match, same as above, but you'll go through a whole box of matches. So instead, we're going to be using an engineering grade hairdryer or a heat gun. So firstly, I'm going to take off the flag from this, and then we can put the flag back on once we've got that sorted out. One other thing you got to be aware of is may shrink slightly down the length of it when you shrink it, so just be aware of that. Remember to get it from all angles. Start at one end and then move down. Third piece is a little different because this only needs to be secured down to about halfway along to allow for this to run out and plug into the bull bar, because this actually goes all the way down to the bottom. So about there.
For some strange reason, the top camera overheated and stopped recording about here. Maybe it has something to do with the maniac waving a heat gun around. While the antenna could be a better match, especially with more attention to getting the base capacitance right, in practice, it works, and it works well, and the VSWR is less than 2-to-1, so I think I'm going to call this a success. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, and see you next time.